Member for Barrow-Terry Sound.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. You know, Madam Speaker, while listening to the member for St. Joseph a while back, it dawned on me that, and I agree with him, that the law takes a while to catch up with reality. And it is so true, because after listening to the discussions, and that has been going back and forth, one would swear that we are still in the dark ages where child marriages are taking place, where young girls are brought kicking and screaming to a marriage that they don't want, and the marriage is by a 75-year-old man or whatever it may be. And it has created such an emotive sort of discussion that, unfortunately, a lot of inaccuracies have taken place. Inaccuracies to such an extent, Madam Speaker, that looking at the past itself and past behavior and sort of extrapolating that onto the future behavior of what is occurring today, things have changed so drastically in a short period of time. But unfortunately, it would appear that it did not change much for the NCC. Because the NCC, Madam Speaker, they seem to be very emotive based on the child marriage bill that has been in the air for a while. And they were able, Madam Speaker, to give a man called Chalk Dust $100,000, $700,000 where he sang a calypso that was completely untrue, that a 75-year-old man and a 14-year-old girl were the ones responsible for getting married. And then he starts to talk about a certain level of pedophilia, he talked about pedophilia, about greasing the copybook with margarine and butter and everything else. And NCC saw it fit to put our man first. And that goes to show you the level, and not only that, Madam Speaker, he only attacked one person, a fellow called Satmaraj, who is an outspoken person for the Hindu religion. And that goes to show, Madam Speaker, the emotive content of this bill, that it has gone up, down, sideways to all different directions, back in the past, not in the future. Because if people are looking at the future, they would see that 18-year-old minor, well, person to get married, which is what I agree with the, we agree with that. 18 years is a good age for marriage, and some states, as I think the member for St. Joseph said, 21 years in India at different places. And as a result of that, we agree with that, based on the assumption that the ages correlate with maturity. You see, Madam Speaker, in science, nothing is absolute. Absolutely nothing is absolute. You can't see. And I talked to my friend from San Fernando West. I know he means well, and he means well because I know him, about the age of 18 for marriage and not below that. But in every part of life, Madam Speaker, there are exceptions to the rule. In science, we call it degrees of freedom. And when you plot a graph, you may have different plus or minuses above that point, and people are aware of it, where you have that degree of freedom, where a range takes place, and then you plot according to the average of the range. So I'm asking the member for San Fernando West, the Attorney General, consider that concept, because you are now entering a realm of absoluteness, for if a better word, and not looking at in areas that are gray on the sides. Even a bell curve, Madam Speaker, a bell curve has the middle part of it, which is the median, the mode, and then you have the two skewed standard deviations. The reason behind that is life. Life is different to what we think has been absolute. Life is not absolute. What may be your your circumstances, as the member for Tobago East was lucky, she was able at the age of 22 to get her degree and go onwards. And I agreed every single thing she says about where she was at, what is supposed to be an age for marriage, etc., and for love. But in life, there are different circumstances among different people. You will have somebody having a circumstance that is completely different to yours. They grew up somewhere and they fall in love at the age of 12 because that's what's going on, and 14, the boy may be 14, and they go forward until they reach about 16, 17, whatever it is. And that is a condition that, as the member for said, Mayaro said, things occur, and somebody might get pregnant. The girl will get pregnant. And they decide that they don't want to go to a backstreet abortionist. The parents may force them into trying to look for some abortion in some form or fashion. The girl may decide that she wants to keep her baby, and the boy may decide he's going to work to take care of a child. But at the age of 16 and 17, how do we deal with that scenario? Do we take the young man and send him into prison because he has committed statutory rape according to the law? Because 18 and below is rape right now as we speak. Or is there circumstances that we could use and say, look, let us have the degrees of freedom with the law. So somebody who is trying to look at the law and deal with the law will not look at it in a sort of an absolute manner like some policemen do and charge somebody for something that really and truly should have some human compassion. You see, Madam Speaker, we have to deal, make law, and also deal with the real world. And they have to combine and they have to mesh at some times. You see, looking at this marriage bill and looking at the previous marriage bill, with the real one, that certain parts of it, they have been deleted. There's a clause 23 and 24 that were deleted. And I think 25 has been changed. 24 and 23 speaks about consent. Consent to marriage, and the word consent to marriage has been taken off, and 23 and 24 has been deleted, and it goes on, and it's now heading contract for a marriage. Contract. It's the age at when a person may contract a marriage, right? Consent is very important. And consent by whom? Right. We speak about consent by the individual, and that's very important. And there's number clause 25, where the caveat you took off are from whose to required, whose consent to a marriage is hereby required. Now it starts off any person who may know of any just cause why the marriage should not take place. That is any person. Now any person could mean the person getting married. Sure.
Very important point you're raising. Just to give you the assurance that it's now congruous with the matrimonial and civil proceedings legislation. The two are read side by side. So the conditionalities for marriage, which is the consent of the individual, are specifically preserved as one of the requirements to contract marriage. So it is there. The removal in those two clauses that you mentioned are important, and what they are is to remove the consent of another person giving consent for the child's marriage. I hope that's helpful.
Thank you very much, Ajit. Because that part of it really, did bother me a little bit. And also at the same time, somebody may not want to give consent and being dragged kicking and screaming into a marriage and they don't want to. And by taking off that consent, well, I'm very glad there's a place for it. Now, I just want to go ahead, Madam Speaker, to speak a little bit about maturity. Now, when the member for St. Joseph indicated that the boy or the young man, the young adult, at the age of 21 is given any boy below the age of 21 is considered not an adult, and any girl below the age of 18 is not considered adult. So 18 for girls, 21 for boys, and that is what I think the Indian legislation said, not our Indian legislation. Madam Speaker, there is a reason and a hidden reason behind why that is so. And I will go back, I'll go right to birth as you move forward. Girls develop at a faster rate than boys, chronologically, maturity, etc. A girl will walk faster than a boy. Boys take a longer time to walk. A girl speaks before a boy. And a girl, they start to speak faster. A girl also holds their bottles earlier than a boy. A boy takes a longer time. There are some exceptions. I'm going after something because you will find that the level of maturity of a girl far exceeds that of a boy as they grow up in a chronological manner. And when you put a boy at the age of 10 and a girl at the age of 10 to write the same exam, you are obviously going to get the girls doing better. And because the chronological age does not match the maturity age. So you will end up now with girls doing better at, let's say, SEA. Boys not doing that well. Keep it going, because but they both go to a secondary school, same ages, same class, and moving up the same way, same exams. Boys at the age of 16 and girls at the age of 16, completely different. The girls are much more mature than boys at the age of 16, as boy, and so you end up now with a skewed response, writing the same exam at the same age. So you will find the girls doing better at the age of at the age of 16 than the boys in GCSE. Well, let's say, a CAPE and whatever it is, CXE. So they go on to A levels, and then obviously university, you have this age equality, but not maturity equality. I've always been an advocate that it must be 2 or 3 years difference. A boy at the age of 12, let's say about 12, and a girl age of 9 should write the exams. That, and it goes on like that. So you'll find that the age of 18, age of 21, boys catch up. And boys start to catch up at that age, and they start to do much better at the age of 21 onwards. Girls, on the other hand, some rise to the top of the corporate ladder, some move out, because the maturity difference and the competition is greater at that level. Boys tend to focus more at that level. They focus direct on something. It's human nature. Well, girls are the gatherers. They multitask. Boys can't multitask. So what you find, Madam Speaker, is a difference in maturity at those ages. And there's a reason for that. There is a scientific reason basis for that. And when we do this, when we have our education system in such a manner, doing exactly what I said this is being done, you will get girls 80% having degrees than boys 20%. And it's showing as a result of the different maturity. Now, the reason I went into that, a girl at the age of 16 and a boy at the age of 18 are basically along the same maturity levels. So I understand when the Attorney General says 18 is a good age for marriage, as you say, and onwards. But there are times when you may find, under some circumstances, the age of 16 for a girl might be necessary to have a marital cohabitation. But I want to go further, Madam Speaker. In today's world, whether you all have been listening to your children or not, none of my daughters have shown me that they want to get married. Neither. They have not. And what they have been telling me is that there's a large world outside there, in the internet, the cloud, and a whole different system that we're not even discussing about here, that there has come a time where we are talking about marriage at the age of 18, dowry, kicking and screaming, but that's long gone. It's gone. We're talking about something that's gone. We're making rules for something that's not there. It's not happening as much. Less than 0.1% of the population. It's less than 0.1%. It's there, yes. We need the rules. We need the rules. But we have to also think outside the box, too. Different things happen differently. And you have the development, Madam Speaker, of the 5- and 10-year marriage contract. It's coming. Because people live longer. I think a male is about 79, and ladies 80-something, or 79 and 74. So people are living longer. Divorces have reached 50% in the United States of America. So you're looking at a different world outside here as compared to what we're legislating for here, Madam Speaker. And the development of the 5-year and the 10-year contract is starting to take root in such marriage contract that if one, and that it needs the two members to agree to it after 5 or 10 years, or else it's null and void. I know they have to work out the problem, the maths about the assets, etc. But what I'm saying is that about 1995, the internet wasn't a great thing. 2000 wasn't much, but look at the internet today. It's gone crazy. I mean, hotels have been disrupted with Airbnb, taxis, Uber, Amazon, destroying every single brick and mortar establishment. That's what's happening now. So when you look at marriage, what happens? Are we legislative? Somebody wants to get married on the internet. What happens? A pastor on the internet with an app decides to get married to people on the internet, an app. How do you stop that? How do you stop that? I'm just throwing out ideas, Madam Speaker, that here we are legislative. We support the legislation, but I'm asking the Attorney General, please make some and give some consideration for the degrees of freedom that may occur. The ones that the member from Mayaro indicated that when the powers that be, the NGOs, the priest, the imam, the pundit, has to be consulted because somebody gets pregnant before under the age. Yeah, we need to take that into consideration rather than being absolute. Because if we don't, Madam Speaker, we are going to end up, and this is just my thoughts, we are going to end up with an increased amount of young people having cohabiting without marriage. It's happening now, but it'll increase. We are going to have what they call illegitimacy, children born outside of marriage to a larger extent. We are going to have, and may have, a high amount of backstreet abortions to prevent the authorities from sending somebody to jail. And we may have a lot of secretive abortions with this legislation. I'm not saying I'm not pushing it on the Attorney General, but if there are no way out, there's nothing to do except an absolute system, you are going to end up, Madam Speaker, with people trying to protect themselves. You are going to get that. And by protecting themselves and taking a different road that is not the real trodden road, you will find people doing different things and could end up in legal problems. So, Madam Speaker, looking at that and dealing with that argument, I want to ask the Attorney General to give it consideration, because we do support the 18-year-old, but with exceptions. The NGOs, the Islamic Women's Group, the Hindu Women's Group, everybody, they have all come out and asked for the exceptions. And I think it's fair, because these organizations are the ones who have to deal with those problems. And they're asking that we, as members of Parliament, give that consideration. So, Madam Speaker, I don't speak long, but I try to keep my thoughts very, very tight. So I want to thank the members for listening, and decided to just throw out some different ideas, because we have spoken a lot about the bill itself and different parts of the bill. So with those few words, Madam Speaker, I thank you.